I hope you've all enjoyed your lunch and had a good time talking to your lunch companions. We can get started now on what I think is going to be a very exciting panel. I want to introduce to you the members of the panel. If I could have everybody's attention, introduce the members of the panel, and then we'll call them up on stage and get started. So we are very fortunate to have Dr. Giovanni Caforio here. He is the CEO and chair of the board of directors of Bristol-Myers Squibb Pharmaceutical Company. I had the honor of serving on the Bristol-Myers board for almost 20 years. It is a wonderful company. Bristol-Myers Squibb is focused on discovering and developing and delivering transformational medicines, and it has done so. These include immunotherapies, which I think you all know about, that are fundamentally changing the way that cancer is treated. Giovanni's leadership has been marked by a strengthened, patient-focused culture, emphasizes the power of innovation, speed, and accountability. Giovanni has also spearheaded Bristol-Myers Squibb Drive to expand its global reach. Our second panelist is Dr. John Maraganore, who is the CEO and director of Alnylam Pharmaceuticals, where he previously served as president. John's career covers a range of high-level experiences that pertain to our topic today, including strategic product development with Millennium Pharmaceuticals, which is now Takeda Oncology, molecular biology, as well as market and business development at Biogen, and biotechnology at Zymogenetics. John's also a member of the Immunology Advisory Council at Harvard Medical School and chair of the Biotechnology Innovation Organization, and as we all know, has had tremendous recent success in gene therapy approaches, and he'll talk more about that. Our third panelist is Dr. Katie Janeway, from Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, and Katie's the Director of Clinical Genomics at Dana-Farber, as well as a Senior Attending Physician in Pediatric Hematology Oncology at Dana-Farber and Boston Children's Hospital. She's an Associate Professor of Pediatrics at Harvard Medical School. She's also the Director of the Solid Tumor Center Program for Dana-Farber Boston Children's, and her own particular interest is in osteosarcoma. She currently sits on a number of national and local committees charged with bringing the power of genomic characterization to patient care and is also an important advocate for us at the FDA. Our fourth panelist is Dr. George Demetri. He is the Senior Vice President of Experimental Therapeutics and Director for the Center of Sarcoma and Bone Oncology, the Quick Family Chair in Medical Oncology, and Professor of Medicine and Co-Director of the Ludwig Center at Harvard Medical School, and Associate Director for Clinical Sciences at Dana-Farber Harvard Cancer Center, which is the largest comprehensive cancer center in the country. George has dedicated his career to translational and clinical research aimed at developing practical therapies from scientific mechanisms. So how do we translate basic discoveries into new medicines for patients? And his particular interest is in sarcomas and life-threatening sarcomas, as well as other cancers. And he was the one who brought Gleevec, a therapy originally designed for chronic myelogenous leukemia, to the realization that it also worked in a gastrointestinal stromal tumor called GIST, which has really changed the treatment of that condition. So, with that, let's get started. So, this morning we ended our panel by asking each of our panelists, who are all from Dana-Farber, what motivates them to do the work they do each day to meet the mission of Dana-Farber. And each of them told a patient story, but there are, of course, other ways and other motivations. And so I thought we would start by asking each one of you, what motivates you to do the very hard work that you're all doing. Why don't we start with you, Giovanni?
Thank you. Thanks, Laurie, and thanks for the opportunity. Good afternoon, everyone. I would say for me, it's very similar. I am a physician by training, and I've been passionate about developing new medicines for 30 years now. What motivates me is every time I have an opportunity to speak to a patient that is benefiting from one of our medicines. It can be the headmaster of the school of my daughter, or the father of one of their friends. It happens to me quite often to get a text message to say, I have received the results of my scan and I'm disease-free. Every one of those messages keeps me going for quite a long time.
Well, I'm gonna say it's pretty similar to what Giovanni just said. A little bit of a difference in the sense I'm a scientist, not a physician, a biochemist by training. And for me, you know, part of the passion around making a difference in patients' lives is linked to the science of what we try to do as an innovator and bringing a new class of medicines forward. And so the excitement around solving a major technical challenge that we had to solve and many people in biotechnology have to solve, to then open up an opportunity for a new medicine and a new class of medicines that can make a difference in patients' lives is something very special, and that drives me every day.
Oh, well, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to sit on the panel today. You know, like the two speakers before me, I would say it's really being able to witness the transformative effect for an individual patient that we can have when we bring together sort of creative approaches to investigation that brings things out of the lab and to the patient's bedside, combined with clinical trials of new oncologic therapies and sort of our ability to have outreach beyond the sort of local area. And I'll tell a quick story if that's okay. So we're, you know, very much modeled on the Profile Project, where every patient who comes to the Dana-Farber is offered the opportunity to participate in a study where we can use the latest sort of molecular testing approaches to interrogate the tumor and try to identify those specific gene abnormalities that might predict response to a targeted therapy. We've had in pediatric oncology, because it's so rare, collaborations with institutions across the country. To do a very similar type of study. We actually recently amended our protocol to allow patients to, very particular types of patients where we think it's likely to find such a molecular abnormality, to allow those patients not to travel to Boston to participate in our study. And we actually had a physician find out about that from my research coordinator who was presenting a poster. We got a call from her. She's saying, you know, I have the perfect patient for your study, I think. We offered the patient the opportunity to participate over the phone. We were able to get the tumor sample to the Dana-Farber, do our usual testing, which indicated a possible genetic abnormality, but not entirely clear. We were able to leverage our relationships to do deeper genomic characterization and identified what's called an NTRK fusion, which is a where two genes switch places and really turn on one of the genes, which really drives the cancer completely. And there happens to be, we happen to be engaged in clinical trials of new drugs against NTRK. We had that trial open. We invited the patient to come up. She started the drug at her first set of scans. I was able to introduce the research coordinator to the patient. And we wish the cameras had been there, because my colleague, Dr. Du Bois, who runs the trial, asked her, so what do you think about the new medicine? And she said, it's the Holy Grail. This is a girl who'd been on chemotherapy for about 3 years for a metastatic sarcoma that hadn't worked and gave her side effects. And he said, well, what do you mean it's the Holy Grail? She said, well, I feel fine and it actually works. So those are the moments that just make all the hard work, you know, it really pays off.
And for me, I'll be very similar in what all my colleagues have said. Thank you for inviting me. It's all about breaking down the barriers right now. The speed of progress is unbelievable. We had one of the first CT scanners at Stanford when I was a first-year medical student. And we were all worried, how are we going to pay for this? The images were fuzzy, but they were still magical. And now CTs are a commodity. Everybody gets CTs. They've changed the world. We don't do as much unnecessary surgery. And now you fast forward to different kinds of smart drugs, different kinds of antibodies, things that are, these NTRK fusion drugs are absolutely remarkable. They're kind of the new Gleevec of the day. And those NTRK fusions can happen in about 0.5% of any cancers. Like, they're everywhere. How are we going to look for them without the kind of genetic profiling that Dana-Farber has pioneered with this profile project that Katie is helping to lead? So it's the ability to use those tools, break down the barriers between blood cancers and breast cancers and lung cancers. We're all coming together into a world where we're going to share the advances together for the good of everybody, and also break down the barriers between academia, between companies that need access to those capital markets to do this kind of expensive research, and then philanthropists, either in individual settings like all of you today, or big foundations. So it's this kind of bringing the world together and all these different stakeholders that brings me to work every day. It's a blessing.
Great. I have a question for Giovanni and John. The healthcare industry is continuing to embrace a patient-centric business model where patient voices are permeating decision-making and strategy. And it would be interesting to hear your thoughts about how patients are engaged in this process and how their insights influence your strategies. John, why don't you go first this time?
Sure. You know, we're engaged at Alnylam in a lot of rare diseases, where, you know, the patient community and the patient input to the entirety of what we do from a drug development and even drug commercialization perspective is central. You know, for example, many of the diseases that we work on, the natural history itself is poorly defined in the academic literature. And oftentimes it's important to engage the patient community in registry studies that allow us to understand longitudinally the nature of the disease course and the disease burden overall, and what the standard of care is for their treatment at the end. More recently, of course, we have engaged the patient community. This is through regulatory processes that were initiated with FDASIA initially, where there's really now a formal process through the drug development cycle, where the patient voice, the patient input in drug development can, in fact, become an important part of how the FDA will look at the structured benefit risk of a given medicine. And so the ability of the FDA, the regulator, to hear from the patient directly what is ailing them, what is bothering them, what's their threshold for uncertainty at some level, is something which, of course, is really critical for the agency to make the right decision around approval of a drug. So it is transformed what we are doing in modern drug development. Of course, we saw pockets of it earlier, most I think poignantly with HIV when it emerged as a scourge, and the patient community was very active there. But it's only become more formal over the last decade or so within the pharmaceutical industry. But it's a central part of how we develop drugs today.
And I would say from our perspective, Laurie, the same. We think it's really important, and every time we have an opportunity to interact with patients, we learn more about what's really critical in their lives every day as they live with a serious disease, but at the same time continue to be fathers, mothers, be busy at home and at work. And we try to be very disciplined in three or four areas. So, for example, we have created patient engagement networks where for every one of the diseases in which we have medicines in development, we engage with groups of patients that tell us whether we're missing something in the design of a clinical trial, whether we should be looking at patient-reported outcomes in clinical trials more systematically, and our patient engagement networks have become really important. We have a lot of focus on information, and so when we started introducing medicines to patients in the area of immuno-oncology, which was a really new area, we decided to spend a lot of time and resources to educate patients directly on how to recognize side effects early, because some of those side effects were very different from traditional chemotherapy. And I think that was really important to make sure that those medicines were used and at the same time they were safe. We also feel that it is important for us to communicate with patients using a language they understand, because sometimes we tend to be very technical and use words that are meaningful to us but very difficult. And so we have a group at Bristol-Myers Squibb that works on what we call the universal patient language. So every one of our communications, the language we use, the way we explain complex scientific concepts, we actually ask patients to help us use the right words, use the right expressions. And many of the materials that we develop, including, for example, the package inserts in our medicines, they are being rewritten by patients in a way that is meaningful to them. And finally, we decided that every one of our clinical trials should be easy to find for a patient. And so we have a platform called Study Connect, which includes all of our ongoing clinical research activities and makes it hopefully easy for a patient to actually look at whether there is a study that they should be discussing with their physician because it looks like the right study for them. So I think this is really, really important for us.
So you've really connected with patients, Giovanni, but you've also connected with the academic community. And to my mind, the interaction between academic medical centers and the private sector is absolutely vital for our patients in accelerating basic science, basic discovery into new treatments for patients. I like to call it a marriage made in heaven, although it's clear that we have to be absolutely transparent about all of our disclosures. And I think I started out by saying that I served on the board of Bristol-Myers Squibb for 20 years, and I'm now on the board of GSK Pharmaceuticals. And we all need to make sure that we're completely transparent. But Bristol-Myers did something I think very interesting in 2012. You formed the International Immuno-Oncology Network, of which Dana-Farber is a member. And I thought it would be great if you could explain what this initiative is and how you think it's actually leading to new innovative treatments for patients.
Yeah, Laurie, I think that was a very, very important initiative. And just to go back a few years ago, this was the beginning of discovering how you can treat cancer in a very different way and use medicines that activate the immune system of a patient to fight cancer. It was a very new modality, a new area of science, and we understood that the potential was great, but there was a lot to be done to understand how to develop new medicines in a very different field, in a very new field. And so we decided to bring together a very small group of academic institutions, and Dana-Farber was one of the founding members of that network. And our objective was to create an environment where scientists could sit together regularly several times a year and in a pre-competitive way, share information that would enable every one of them to continue to make progress faster than if they were working on their own or if we were working in isolation in our labs. And we created a network that expanded over time to include some institutions overseas and some of the most advanced cancer centers in the world. And I think that the rapid progress that has been made in the field of immuno-oncology was really due in great part to the ability of researchers to work together, whether coming from the industry, in this case our company, or some of the best academic institutions in the world. They were able to work together and really understand much faster how to bring a totally new class of medicines to patients in a way that I think would not have been possible if we had remained closed in our labs and if we had not created, together with Dana-Farber and a few other centers around the world, the right ecosystem for collaboration.
Katie, just over a year ago, a new healthcare law, the FDA Reauthorization Act, was approved, aimed at lowering prescription drug prices amid skyrocketing health insurance costs. And one critical component of that FDA Reauthorization Act, which I'm sure you were involved with, was the Research to Accelerate Cures and Equity for Children Act, or RACE for Children Act. Can you tell us something about how this legislation has enhanced the drug development process by making it more patient-focused, and how it's changed the way cancer clinical trials are conducted specifically for our youngest patients?
Sure. So, Laurie, as you allude to in the question, the FDA Reauthorization Act of 2017, which, by the way, is an 89-page law, has
That's
a number of
FDA,
important components.
Right?
but to prevent lulling our audience into a postprandial nap with the details, I've made a few notes to make sure I focus on the relevant components of the Race for Children Act. The Act really addresses requirements for clinical trials of new oncology drugs in children. Let me provide some important background. First, clinical trials of oncology drugs in children have often, although not always, lagged quite far behind those clinical trials in adults, such that children are not able to access those new effective therapies until long after they have been FDA approved for adult patients. Second, a very brief refresher on precision oncology, which we started during the responses to the initial question. As I think many of you in the audience appreciate by now, our approach to treating patients now relies not only on stage and disease entity, but also identifying for the individual patient those aberrations or abnormalities in the cancer that is leading to proliferation, to spread, and to evasion of the immune response. These cancer-promoting aberrations, which are also called molecular targets, really can signal or indicate that a particular targeted therapy might be especially effective. The classes of targeted cancer therapies in oncology continue to increase, from small molecule targeted therapies like the NTRK inhibitor I mentioned, or imatinib, actually all the way through immuno-oncology, which now is really thought of as a targeted therapy against something called microsatellite instability or mismatch repair deficiency. Because of this, in the past year, we've seen for the first time an FDA approval of a drug, which is an immune checkpoint inhibitor, for specifically a molecular target or a set of molecular targets, which I just mentioned, that mismatch repair deficiency and microsatellite instability. So now for the bit of dry legalese. Traditionally, clinical trials were focused on demonstrating effectiveness in a specific disease entity. And the regulations aimed at promoting clinical trials in children which is called the Pediatric Research Equity Act, also addressed cancer type. And because the majority of trials of new cancer drugs were aimed at cancer types that are very common in adults and very rare in children, most of the new drugs were sort of exempt from those from that Pediatric Research Equity Act because the cancer type did not occur in children. So what the RACE Act for Children does is it really refocuses that regulation so that it's aimed at promoting clinical trials of oncology drugs in children away from cancer type and towards the molecular target. So now new pharmaceutical companies proposing trials of new cancer drugs that are targeted and address a molecular target are required to develop a pediatric research plan if the molecular target of that therapy is relevant in a pediatric cancer. In these pediatric assessment plans, they outline how they plan to study the dosing, safety, and activity in all the patients where there's relevance of that molecular target. One other thing to mention is that in addition to the Race for Childhood Cancer Act, the FDA recently issued guidance that is aimed at promoting access to clinical trials for younger patients. This guidance states that once a dose and safety is understood for a drug, that a trial eligibility should be open so that patients 12 and above can more easily enroll in that trial. The bottom line is that the outcome of the RACE Act and the new FDA guidance regarding eligibility at age 12 means that our patients in the pediatric oncology clinic will begin to see clinical trials of new oncology drugs much earlier in their life cycle of development. And these clinical trials will, in many cases, enroll patients from across disease types and across the age spectrum. Fortunately, the Dana-Farber is uniquely positioned to partner with industry in bringing these trials to our patients in the setting in which they feel most comfortable being treated. So Drs. Armstrong, Du Bois, and I from pediatrics have all advised the FDA, as you mentioned, at various steps in the approach to implementation of the RACE Act. We are probably the only place where we bring together a cancer center and top-rated children's hospital and pediatric and adult cancer programs. All of our patients, regardless of age, have their cancers tested for molecular targets under the same research umbrella profile and using the same molecular platforms, the Rapid Heme Panel and OncoPanel. And the pediatric and adult cancer programs conduct clinical trials under a unified Office of Human Subjects Research. What that means is that we're already actually able to implement both the FDA guidance and the Race for Children Act. When BMS, Giovanni's company, lowered the age of eligibility on one of their phase two trials of an active immunotherapy, I'm going to butcher the name, Relatlinib. Thank you. I worked with Dr. Hody, who had worked with BMS to bring that trial to Dana-Farber to make sure that we were able to offer that effective immunotherapy trial in our pediatric oncology clinic. And then the story I told you earlier was made possible by the fact that for the last 3 years, the sarcoma clinic and the pediatric oncology clinic have been collaborating with industry to bring a basket trial aimed at NTRK fusions to both locations. I think we're very hopeful that will lead to very soon to another FDA approval that crosses both age and disease barriers.
That's great. And the good news is that the budget was passed on September 28th, which is probably the NIH budget, which is probably the first time in I don't know how many years that this has happened on time. And there was an increase of $2 billion for NIH funding. And part of that, Katie, was the STAR program, which is dedicated specifically to supporting research, pediatric research, and pediatric survivorship. So that's the good news. So George, I have a question for you about the FDA as well. They established the Oncology Center of Excellence, which was the first center at the FDA that was dedicated to a specific disease rather than the FDA's traditional orientation. To have centers with responsibility for regulating specific product areas. Has this been a good thing? Has it led to improvements in working with the FDA? What have been some of the early benefits for patients?
So let me say, we are so lucky in the field of cancer medicine to have this FDA. It's led by a guy named Rick Pazder, who was a practicing GI oncologist from the MD Anderson. Before about, 17 years ago, he went to the FDA to lead this Office of Oncology Drug Products. As Laurie said, the old FDA had a drugs branch and a diagnostics branch, and if you're presenting data on a new cancer drug, you could be talking to people who knew nothing about cancer. And Rick said, that doesn't make sense. Cancer is so specialized, and the expertise is increasing so fast, it makes sense to harness the expertise in a new subdivision of the FDA called the Oncology Center of Excellence. And of course, then the cardiologists raise their hand, we want a cardiology center of excellence, the neurologists say, wait a minute, don't forget about Alzheimer's and Parkinson's, we want a neurology center of excellence. And Scott Gottlieb, who is, in my opinion, really one of the most effective federal officials right now, he's an incredible head commissioner of the FDA, Scott Gottlieb agreed to have the Oncology Center of Excellence go forward first, and it has been a terrific opportunity. First and foremost, our federal FDA officials, the physicians who work there, they don't get paid a lot, and they can't consult outside the FDA, and they are real public servants. They love what they do. They are very dedicated to preserving the public health. And this gives Rick Pazder and his whole team an opportunity to really bring in the best and the brightest, and they've done that. They have an incredible group of people working at the FDA. they are dedicated to taking the kind of science you just heard about as fast as possible and bringing it to patients. Let me tell you, many of us helped craft a law that was called the Breakthrough Therapy Legislation based on talking to Congress, talking to Friends of Cancer Research, and talking to the FDA about what do you need to do your jobs better. And they said, we really need legislation to let us do our jobs, to use our professional judgment about what's a reasonable risk-benefit, just like John had said before, assessing the benefits and the risks and saying, we're professionals, we can assess that, we're not blind, and we need some judgment calls. We need to exercise that. The breakthrough therapy legislation also allows the FDA to give companies and academics a chance to do concierge service, to get in there earlier so that mistakes don't get made. It used to be like running an obstacle course. You jump over this, jump over that. Finally, you're almost at the end. You trip over something. And the FDA is trying to prevent that from happening because that's expensive and it's not good for patients. So it's a privilege to work with this FDA right now. It's a privilege to work as an academic in collaboration with industry. And it's also a privilege, in the interest of full disclosure, I'm one of the few Dana-Farber faculty who sits on the board of public biotech companies. I have two biotech companies on whose public board I sit, to really bring the power of what I consider my first priority, Dana-Farber, the good of the patients. How can I sit on the board and help advise these biotech companies how they might develop their drugs as fast, effectively as possible to get them to patients? The price I pay is that I recuse myself from any research they're doing. We need to preserve the public trust in us as academics. And so I'm willing to do that, and it actually helps me because then I can give projects to other younger faculty at Dana-Farber, help build their careers, do the right thing, and yet stay out of supervising them so there's no conflict. So I think we have put in place a very wonderful organization at Dana-Farber that allows us to do our jobs, collaborate the best as we can with industry, and then work with the FDA, advise them to help bring things to patients as quickly and effectively as possible.
So John, you're not in cancer. But
not now,
you were, but in August, after many years of really groundbreaking work, Alnylam received FDA approval of a first of its kind gene therapy, RNAi therapeutic, and called Onpattro for patients with polyneuropathy. And I really would love to hear what your experience was over the many years that you pushed forward with this and really finally achieved this milestone for patients with a hereditary disease. So can you just tell us a little bit about what that was like?
Well, I'll give you the abridged version. How's that?
That's good.
we started 16 years ago on this effort. There was an amazing discovery in science, in academic groups, won the Nobel Prize several years later by Andy Fire and Craig Mello around a natural mechanism that all of us have in our body to turn off gene expression at the level of RNA. So it's a way of regulating how our cells work by basically regulating the expression and the ultimate translation of RNA into protein. As all of you remember, DNA goes to RNA, goes to protein. So RNA interference regulates protein production at the RNA level. And we got started with, frankly, a crazy bold vision to try to harness that natural pathway to develop a whole new class of medicines that could regulate the production of bad proteins involved in disease at the level of RNA. And that's what our mission was back in 2002. We were founded by a number of prominent scientists in the Boston area, Phil Sharp, notably at MIT, many others as well. Venture capitalists brought money into the company. Entrepreneurs got recruited to the company. And there we went. We launched this company on this big, bold vision. Well, we've been at this for 16 years. It took us about a decade to figure out how to solve some of the many, many, many technical challenges that occur when you start with basic science and have to go into making medicines. And we, over the 16-year period, just to give you an example of this, we invested about $2.5 billion as a company. We're not going to be profitable, by the way, for another 4 or 5 years. We invest close to $1 billion a year as a company in what we do. So we rely on the capital markets to basically be able to fund, and sometimes partnerships with pharmaceutical companies to do what we do. But we've just launched our first drug. We just brought our first medicine forward for a rare disease called hereditary ATTR amyloidosis. Affects about 50,000 people around the world. And we're now engaged in directly marketing and selling the product and bringing it to patients around the world as a company. But again, what's remarkable about a journey like this is how many challenges, how many obstacles have to be overcome. At the end of the day, when you get there, you deserve a reward, and we will hopefully be rewarded for what we've done. And then there will be many more medicines that come after that. So it's really the beginning of a whole flow of medicines that can impact disease and ultimately cancer as well. But right now we're focusing on some rare diseases as our initial focus area.
Well, I can't resist asking this question given the news lately of Trump's announcement last Thursday to lower drug prices. And there's and a different mechanism for paying for them, which would certainly negatively impact Dana-Farber and also pharmaceutical companies. So this is obviously very preliminary. The proposal is out there for comment until, I think, spring. But I'm curious as to, I'd like to you to talk a little bit about it and give us your thoughts about its viability. Giovanni, maybe you want to start.
Sure. I mean, what I would say is the following. So, first of all, it is clear that in many countries around the world, the cost of healthcare is growing, and in many countries around the world, the cost of healthcare is growing faster than the economy, faster than GDP, and that is an issue for everybody, whether it's a government or a private market-driven system, that we have to deal with. At the same time, you know, in the United States, in particular, in many cases, the affordability of medicines for patients is an issue because our current system, in terms of the way insurance plans are written, is shifting more and more cost to patients. And at a time in which really the price of medicines is not increasing, the cost of medicines to patients in terms of what they're responsible for has increased quite significantly. And I'm saying all of this to say that we as an industry clearly recognize the need for a dialogue with the administration and physicians and healthcare providers on how do we work together to find a mechanism that enables us to continue to make the extraordinary progress that you were describing, because we're making progress like never before, that enables the industry to be rewarded for the investments we made, we make in innovation, healthcare providers and research institutions like Dana-Farber to be able to work effectively in the environment. You know, we do it in a way that we all agree is sort of the best way forward. I don't think actually comparing the price of medicines to in the US to price of medicines in other parts of the world is the right thing to do. First of all, patients in some parts of the world wait years before they have access to healthcare and new medicines, and we definitely don't want that to happen in the United States. We should be working to ensure that other governments recognize the value of innovation and reward innovation better, instead of having sort of those issues here. And remember that medicines only represent you know, about 10 to 15% of total healthcare cost, whether you look at the United States or other countries around the world. So we are very much for dialogue, and one where you know, research institutions can continue to invest in finding new therapies, companies are rewarded for the investments they made in innovation, patients have affordable out-of-pocket exposures, but I don't think it is through sort of interventions that are modeled against countries in which access to healthcare is really challenging for patients that we're going to be making progress in these countries. So we're following that dialogue very closely. but we're going to continue to take the perspective that we need a model where patients have access to medicines the day they get approved, and where we work together to make sure that those medicines remain affordable without sort of limiting access or destroying what is a very good system.
I mean, I couldn't agree more with what Giovanni just said. I would just maybe to add a couple of other perspectives to this, which I think are important as part of the dialogue. We all have to remember that the medicines we pay for today as a society are essentially free for our kids and for our kids' kids, because we have a social contract with Hatch-Waxman and generic drugs that become available when a proprietary drug comes off patent or loses its exclusivities, which typically is 10 to 12 years after a new medicine is introduced. And thereafter, that medicine, when new generic entrants come forward, essentially is reduced in price by substantial levels. I call it free, but it's not really free, but it's very, very reduced, 70, 80% of the brand price, and it's available for society forever. So we don't talk very much today about the cost and burden of hypertension or the cost and burden of ulcer treatments, because those medicines are generic. They're available oftentimes on the pharmacy counter. And they obviously don't burden society whatsoever. But there was a time in which that innovation had to get rewarded for the people that brought that innovation forward. And so that is a system that we have in this country, which I think is really fundamental to preserve innovation. The other thing I'll add to this is, imagine the cost of not treating some diseases. What's the cost of not treating Alzheimer's? What's the cost of continuing to have cancer mortality rates as high as they are? They've gotten better, but they're still very high. That's priceless, and we need to have a system that enables innovation to come forward, to get rewarded, to then become available at a lower cost, but to make sure that that innovation system is there. In our country, when we talk about referring our prices to other countries, the innovation comes from our country, from here. It doesn't come from the other countries because they have that system, right? So we have to be very careful. And you know, we do want to have a dialogue. Our industry has a role to play to get to the right answer, and we are very actively engaged to get to the right answer. Everybody has to give a little bit to make this work. But some of the proposals are really not smart.
Well, I think the good news is that Scott Gottlieb is doing a very good job at the FDA and is focusing on getting generics into market as soon as possible. And 90% of prescriptions are for generics.
Correct.
And the drugs that cost more are transformative drugs, like the ones that have come from biotech companies and biopharma companies and pharma companies. I think those are the drugs we want to really focus on. So in the short time we have left, I ask each of you to close with your perspective on what are the key actions we need to take in the short term to hasten the delivery of innovative treatments to our patients. What can we do to make this a faster process? George, why don't you start?
Down this end, okay. I think we just need to keep our eye on the prize. Dana-Farber is a prize in the world. This is a unique environment, and there are several other academic cancer centers that are also unique. We do cancer research and therapeutic development better than any other country on the planet. I will say that to the Swiss. I will say that still to the Chinese. I want to keep that true. I don't say that to be obnoxiously nationalistic. I say that because we've worked hard over the last 50 years or more at Dana-Farber to build a culture of basic science, talking to clinical science, going back and forth with the support of the patients. And I think what we need to do is just keep that strong, because as you've heard, these economic influences are at risk. It is potentially an existential threat for a very successful model that is really bringing good to the whole world. And I want to just keep the focus on that. I want to keep our faculty engaged. I want to keep everybody positive and keep the kind of strengths that we have here going, because the pace of progress, as John said, is mind-boggling. Things that were not even thought of 2 years ago are things that now have to be done to save lives today. So we need to just keep that focus on.
I'm going to go back to something that George mentioned earlier, which is to continue the process that has been initiated and sort of ingrained in the culture at Dana-Farber to break down barriers that exist in many other healthcare institutions, barriers between, as you mentioned, clinical research and basic research, barriers between pediatric oncology and medical oncology, barriers sometimes that exist between interaction between academia and the pharmaceutical, our pharmaceutical partners. So I think that, you know, we are on a great path to sort of that deep interaction, and I think we only need to continue to do that.
Yeah, maybe along the same veins, I'll start by saying, you know, what's really remarkable about this time is that we can actually use the word cures. And we never used to be able to use that in our lexicon. It was sort of a bit forbidden because we would be worried about creating false hope. But we do have curative therapies that are emerging from the scientific work that's going on and what's going on in industry. And we can use the word. We can use it proudly. So I think it really is an amazing time, and it's an opportunity to really treat disease in fundamentally new ways, which is very exciting for all of us. But I do think one thing, to Katie's point a little bit, is we need to collaborate, right? Because we have this wonderful ecosystem between academic medicine, academic research, industry, regulators, in the public sector, other stakeholders as well, payers, and we all have to collaborate together to make this work at the end of the day. And I do worry sometimes about new hurdles that emerge, for example, that might prevent academic researchers working and talking and partnering with industry. This would be a problem. It'd be a major challenge, but I'm hopeful that we'll get through these moments.
And I just want to echo the words that have been said by others. I believe we are, for as much as we've already accomplished, I truly believe we are just at the beginning of another extraordinary scientific revolution. I think this is one where if we work together, we can actually make progress much faster than we've ever done. And to me, the secret is moving from a system where every one of us played our own role somewhat independently to working together collaboratively in an ecosystem of innovation. I believe this is a unique place here in Boston, and I must say, you know, on the 26th of November, my company will open a new research facility here. 400 of our researchers will move to Boston. They will be working full-time on understanding cancer biology even better. And the reason why we've made that decision is because we want to have not daily but twice a day interactions with institutions like Dana-Farber, because it's only if we work together day and night that we'll be able to translate science into medicine and be more successful at doing that faster.
And on that wonderful note, let's thank our panelists. Thank you so much.